right, good morning and welcome to Palm City Presbyterian Church. Let's stand and worship like we always do. Here we go.
all of you. Pay attention, O earth, and all that is in it, and let the Lord be witness against you, the Lord, from his holy temple. Good morning. Please be seated. Our opening verse this morning coming from the beginning of the book of Micah. You'll be here about more about Micah in just a few minutes. Good to see you in the house of the Lord today. Sometimes we just have to hold on, don't we, and persevere. It's good that we can be together to worship God. Don't forget our baby bottles. CareNet is one of our ministry partners. They support young women in pregnancy and children and families and men. We want to support what they're doing, so get one of those baby bottles if you haven't. Fill that up and bring it back by July 26th, our baby bottle campaign. Also, the offering, you know, we're not passing an offering plate these days because then there would be germs possibly on the plate. So the plate sits right back there on a table for those of you who want to give an offering this morning. And I want to thank you for your generous support of our congregation. We've invested in some audio-visual equipment, new cameras and things like that, so that we can improve the quality of what we're putting online these days. We have our own equipment, our own people doing that, and it's exciting to see our technological capabilities expand. The month of July is starting in just a few days, and I know that you are all eagerly awaiting the Palm City Presbyterian Church newsletter, which will be on our website on Wednesday or maybe even before. And of course, we'll have printed copies in the office and here next week. But you should really pay attention to this month's newsletter. You know, there's a lot of unrest in our country these days, starting with the killing of George Floyd, and there were been protests and riots and this and that, and all kinds of things going on in our nation. And what do we do with that, and how do we as a church respond to that? I've written an article called What Can We Do to Help America? And I encourage you to read that article. It's coming out this week, probably in a couple days. It'll be on our website, so go to our website, look at the newsletter, and I kind of spell out some practical steps that we can take to help our nation in this difficult time, and I encourage you to read that. Also in the newsletter, you will read about our new communications coordinator. Starting July 13th, we're going to have a communications coordinator. This is a part-time position, and we have hired Kelly Tullidge to be our communications coordinator. She has designed the last couple of newsletters, so you can see some of her handiwork, but she's going to be kind of the central brain of the operations in terms of calendars and scheduling and getting information out, all our publications and things like that. We're excited. We think that this is going to be important as we expand the ministry God has given us to do, and we're excited that she's going to be a part of our team. Today is June 28th, and unless I'm wrong, that means tomorrow is June 29th. Historically, June 29th is the day that the church celebrates the martyrdom of St. Paul, and because of that, it has been named the International Day of the Christian Martyr. It's a time for Christians all over the world to remember and give thanks for those who have given their lives for the sake of the gospel. Today, we're praying for the persecuted church in the Central African Republic, and it just so happens that the martyr being highlighted this year on the Day of the Christian Martyr is from the Central African Republic. Pastor Jean-Paul Sankagui planted a church in a Muslim neighborhood outside the capital of the Central African Republic, and for more than two decades, he enjoyed a good relationship with the community. But civil war changed that. Most of the pastor's congregation fled the area because of increasing hostility toward Christians, and even his wife Mary encouraged him to leave. But he felt that God had called him to that place, and he wouldn't abandon it, and so he stayed. On February 7, 2017, Islamists shot Pastor Jean-Paul to death outside his church before looting and burning his home and his church. Mary said they killed her husband because the community no longer wanted Christians in the area. She and the pastor had been married for 48 years. They had 11 children and 17 grandchildren. After her husband's death and the destruction of her home, she had no choice but to leave the area. Five other evangelical pastors in the region were killed in the first few weeks of 2017. Pastor Jean-Paul knew the risks, But he took them because he felt that God had called him to minister in that place. And he gave his life for the sake of the gospel. Tomorrow we remember all those who gave their lives for the gospel in the place to which God called them. So let us pray for our brothers and sisters in the Central African Republic. Give thanks for the faithful witness of many. Will you lift your hearts now to God in prayer? Who is like you, O Lord? Holy, mighty, faithful, and wise. You are gracious to us. You keep your covenant promises to us. Although we fail you, you never fail us. Our love is small, but your love is vast. This morning we come to remember your works. We ask you to speak your word to us, to teach our hearts to delight in you. For if we delight in you, anything you ask us to do will be a joy rather than a burden. We thank you for the witness of faithful martyrs, including Jean-Paul Sankajewi. We thank you for our brothers and sisters in the Central African Republic. And we praise you that nothing can stop the gospel, that your Holy Spirit is at work around the world. And we pray that you would strengthen your church, comfort your church, support those who are suffering, Lord. And may we live to your glory. May we resolve to be faithful where you have put us, wherever that is. We pray for our church, that you would help us to shine forth the light of Jesus Christ in this place. Bring us through these trying times, Lord, and help us to make a difference in our community and our nation. We pray for our nation, for its leaders. Lord, we pray for the church. We praise you for your love and your grace and your faithfulness. And Lord, we want you to know that we love you. And so we pray as Jesus taught us, say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones,
really special to me, and I just want to encourage you guys all in times of trouble, and just remember that even when we don't see it, he's working in our lives, and we might not be able to see it, but he never stops, and he never stops working.
You are here.
standing for the reading of God's Word. God's Word comes to us today from Micah chapter 6. Hear now the Word of the Lord. Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised, and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. One goal of my preaching is to teach you the Bible. I want you to read Scripture with comfort and familiarity. And for that reason, I sometimes lead expeditions into the lesser known corners of Scripture. The series we begin today is such an expedition, three sermons on the book of Micah. Most people know Micah, if they know him at all, as the prophet who foretold that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Micah 5:2. That's the verse the scribes quoted when the wise men were looking for Jesus. But Micah is much more than just a part of the Christmas story, important though that is. And he has much more to tell us about Jesus. Another reason I like to foray into the lesser known corners of Scripture is we always find Jesus there. So let's listen to Micah and take to heart his question: who is like the Lord? Let me share with you why I like Micah and why you should too. Micah's name means who is like the Lord, and it is an appropriate name because that was basically his message. Micah lived in a time of change and fear. Back in Micah's day, which was the 8th century BC, people were looking for security in all the wrong places. The king trusted in military alliances with unreliable allies. The elite trusted their wealth. And nearly everybody trusted foreign gods and idols. They forgot the Lord. Actually, they didn't forget him so much as they stopped listening to him. And they stopped obeying him. And consequently, their conception of God, their understanding of God, shrank until their God was too small. And this caused them to make a fatal theological error. They imagined that God was like them. So instead of humbling themselves before God, they treated God like one of their corrupt officials. Give him a bribe, and he'll give you what you want. Micah shows us a big God. Or maybe a better way to say that would be the one true and living God spoke through Micah to show us that he is far, far bigger than we ever imagined. This book of Micah is basically a collection of his sermons. Think of it like a greatest hits album. It's worth listening to. Another reason I like Micah is he lifts up God's grace and faithfulness without compromising God's holiness. And this is so important. Throughout this book, we find the twin themes of judgment and grace. And both of them show us God's goodness. Judgment, you see, needed to come. Micah began his preaching career during the reign of King Jotham. Micah lived in the country of Judah. He was from a town about 20 miles from Jerusalem. King Jotham was a good king and basically did what God wanted him to do. Micah ended his career during the reign of King Hezekiah, who was also a good king, one of the best God's people ever had. But most of Micah's prophetic ministry happened during the 20-year reign of King Ahaz. And Ahaz was not a good king. He was a wicked king. He was corrupt. He was greedy. He was idolatrous. Ahaz even sacrificed some of his own children to idols. And the nation followed him in his wickedness. Micah's ministry was a time of economic crisis in Judah. The middle class was disappearing as the powerful drove farmers off their ancestral lands. God had intended that each family would have their land. And this would mean that there would be a large middle class and not many rich and not many poor. But the powerful were pushing the farmers off their ancestral lands, and this meant that you had a few rich and many, many who were poor. The judges were corrupt. The prophets would say whatever you wanted for the right price. The priests no longer taught God's law. And so the dispossessed had no voice. Meanwhile, crooked business practices were common. Violence was common. And religion was a mess. Almost everybody worshiped various foreign gods and idols. They still worshiped the Lord, but that had become perfunctory. True faith and heart righteousness were rare. In the middle of all this insanity, Micah spoke God's word. And he warned of judgment. He said, God isn't going to stand for this much longer. God is very patient. He gives us time to repent. But he has his limits. And if we don't repent, we're going to get what's coming to us. And believe me, that message was no more popular then than it is today. However, Micah also preached grace. He said that God is faithful, even when we are not faithful. And God always keeps his covenant promises. A covenant, of course, is a relationship of grace. Marriage, for example, is a covenant. God binds himself to his people by a covenant. That means that if you belong to Jesus Christ, you are part of God's covenant family. And this is how the book of Micah is relevant to us, this idea of covenant. Yes, we too live in a time of change just as they did, and we too feel a need for security. But the real relevance to us is the covenant, because the same God who dealt with them deals with us. And when we see how he dealt with them, we know how he deals with us. And when we see how big God was then, we know how big God is today. So let's ask with Micah, who is like the Lord? In this series, we're going to go straight through Micah chapter 6. And today we begin with verses 1 through 5. Micah was very creative. He expressed his message in a memorable way. And so in today's scripture reading, it takes the form of a lawsuit. God is bringing a lawsuit against his people. God is the plaintiff, Israel is the defendant, and the mountains are the jury. You may be wondering, why are the mountains the jury? Did everyone else weasel out of jury duty and the mountains were stuck? Actually, the mountains are the perfect jury for this case because they know the facts of the case. You see, the mountains were there from the beginning. And the mountains saw when God called Moses on a mountain and sent him to Egypt, and how God brought his people out of Egypt and made a covenant with them on a mountain, and how God's people broke that covenant and were unfaithful while Moses was on the mountain, but God forgave them and brought them into the promised land and established them there and dwelt among them in his temple, which was on a mountain. So the mountains know, and they're the perfect judge for this case. It's all a literary device, of course, but Micah makes his point in a memorable way. God is pressing his lawsuit against his people. It says the Lord has an indictment against his people and he will contend with Israel. But as soon as we hear the lawsuit, we realize Israel is the one with the complaint. God's people are the one complaining. Look at verse 3. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me. In other words, God is saying to them, what have I done to you that you treat me this way? Let me ask you something. Is your discipleship, your commitment to Jesus Christ, is that ever a burden? You worship God, read the Bible, pray, give, serve, more out of obligation than joy? I'm not saying you don't have an obligation. You do. What I'm saying is God wants the obligation to feel like a joy, not a burden. Like when two people who are in love get married. You know, I do a wedding. I do premarital counseling, and I'll have a young man sitting there and the woman he's going to marry, and they're looking at each other and they're all starry-eyed, and I'm trying to tell them about, you know, the practical realities of marriage and impress on them what a serious commitment this is. Now you're God's partner in caring for her, and she's God's partner, you're God's partner in caring for him, and this takes commitment, and it takes a lot of grace and perseverance. It's not always going to be easy. But no matter how much I talk about the obligations of marriage, it all seems like a joy to them. They just stand there staring at each other and sighing. One of the great things about church is you get to know people of all different ages. And so you meet people who've been married for 50 or 60 or even more years. And you see how they stick together. And that is a beautiful thing, because we know it's not always easy. And sometimes we see where one spouse's health will begin to fail, and the other spouse has to take care of that person. And we see what a commitment that is. Is that an obligation? Yes. But hopefully it's more than that. Hopefully there's love and caring. And love, you see, makes an obligation enjoyable. And even should the burden become so great that it cannot be enjoyed, love at least makes it bearable. The problem with God's people in Micah's day was they were trying to keep the law without love. And they saw God's law as a burden. It was in their way. It was oppressive and repressive. God wasn't letting them be who they wanted to be. God wasn't letting them do what they wanted to do. God was standing in the way of human flourishing. God was standing in the way of progress. That's how they saw it. It's how many people see it today. But God's people should know better. They said to God, "We can't keep these laws." And God said to them, "You've missed the whole point. You think my relationship with you is some kind of transaction? You do this and I do this. I have always, always acted toward you in sheer grace. And if you can't see that, then of course my law is going to be a burden to you. Unless you understand my love for you and the grace that I have given you so that you love me, of course it's going to be a burden and not a joy." Their problem was they were trying to keep the law without love. They were being religious and doing religious stuff, but they didn't love God. No wonder they were miserable. Well, in verses 4 and 5, God brings evidence. He reminds them of his grace. He takes them back to those formative events that made them a nation and God's people. Verse 4 says, "For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam." The events of the Exodus are well known, how the Egyptians enslaved the Israelites, how God sent Moses to rescue them, how God struck Egypt with plagues because Pharaoh refused to let them go. Aaron was Moses' brother. He and his sons became the priests in the tabernacle, and later their descendants, priests in the temple. Miriam was Moses' sister, and she led their singing as they celebrated at the Red Sea. The Exodus was the event that solidified God's relationship with Israel. The Ten Commandments began, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt." Everything went back to that event. And it was grace. Grace. They were slaves, they were helpless, and God rescued them and he made them his people. And they hadn't earned that. And God didn't expect to be repaid. God only asked one thing of them. He only laid one obligation on them. And it was, well, we'll get to that in a moment. Let's look at verse 5. Verse 5 mentions events that happened between Israel and the promised land. "Oh, my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him." Here's what that's about. So when Israel showed up on the border of Moab, ready to cross over into the promised land, King Balak of Moab was alarmed. The Israelites had no intention of fighting him or of settling his land, but he didn't like the idea of having them in the neighborhood. He didn't think he could fight them, so he hatched a scheme. He would get a prophet to curse them and so destroy them. Balaam was the prophet he sought to hire. God told Balaam, "Don't go to Balak." But the thing was, Balak was paying really well. And so Balaam really wanted to go. And finally God said, "Okay, you can go, but be careful, only do what I tell you to do." And while Balaam was going to see Balak, an incident happened that is one of my favorite passages in the Bible because there's a character in it that reminds me of me. It's the incident when Balaam's donkey spoke. So Balaam's going along, and God isn't happy with him because of where he's going, and God puts an angel in his path to kill him. The donkey sees the angel and stops. But Balaam doesn't see the angel, so he beats the donkey and he curses the donkey. And finally, God gives the donkey speech. And the donkey talks to Balaam. And suddenly, Balaam can see the angel. And he takes to heart God's message to only do and say what I tell you. Do you know, Balaam's donkey is the patron saint of preachers. It's true. Because if God can deliver his message through a donkey, he can deliver his message through me. Let me tell you, if you're a preacher, that's a great comfort. All right? That's a great comfort. So anyway, Balaam goes on and he sees Balak, and Balak tells him, "Curse this people Israel." So Balaam gets up to curse them, and instead he blesses them. And every time he tries to curse them, he blesses them. God would not let him curse God's people. Well, verse 5 continues. "And what happened from Shittim to Gilgal?" Shittim was the last place Israel camped before entering the promised land, and Gilgal was the first place they camped in the promised land, but something happened in between, and this too is testimony to God's grace. Balak had tried to destroy Israel by having them cursed. God foiled his plan. But then Israel almost did the job for him. While they were camped at Shittim, the men of Israel became enamored, shall we say, of the women of Moab. And the women of Moab seduced them into worshiping the god of Moab. And it wasn't long until nearly everyone in Israel was worshiping the god of Moab. So the Lord had brought them out of slavery in Egypt. He had made a covenant with them. He had sustained them through the wilderness. He had brought them right to the edge of the promised land. And now, when all their hopes and dreams are right before their eyes and they're this close, they blow it by worshiping a worthless idol, like an Olympic athlete who stumbles and falls mere feet from the finish line. They blow it. Lest we judge them too harshly, who among us has not almost ruined God's good plan for our life? God might have said good riddance to them right then and there and been done with them. But he didn't. He did send a measure of judgment, but he sent a much greater measure of grace. And he brought them into the promised land, and at Gilgal, he renewed his covenant with them. The covenant they had broken, God made it new again at Gilgal. Now, Micah said that the mountains would be the jury in this case, but I'd like to ask you to render a verdict. Did God burden his people? Was he unfair to them? Or did he always act toward them in love and grace? Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I put to you that the answer to these questions is clear. And there is only one verdict you can return. God loved his people, but they failed to love him. He only asked one thing of them. He only put one obligation on them, and it's right there in verse 5. Remember. Remember. All they had to do was remember the grace of God, and they would know his love for them, and then his law would not be a burden. It would be a joy because they would love God. So what about you? Do you love God for the things he can give you? Do you love God because he loved you? Or do you not love God at all? If Micah were here today, he would remind us of different evidence. He would remind us that God loved us by becoming one of us. The eternal Son of God humbled himself, took flesh, and became a human being for our sake. He suffered for us. He died on the cross in our place so that we could be forgiven and have eternal life. And the Father raised him from the dead and exalted him to the Father's right hand, and then he poured out the Holy Spirit to create his church so that you could hear the gospel. And that's grace too, that you have heard the gospel, the good news that through Jesus Christ you can be a part of God's covenant family and inherit eternal life. And even if you've never heard that before today, you've heard it now. And that's grace. And if you believe it, you are part of God's covenant family. He has reached out and made you his own. And that's grace. It is grace upon grace upon grace. Remember the grace of God, because that is going to make the difference. It's going to draw your heart toward God rather than away from God. And let me illustrate what I mean by that. There were two women who suffered terribly. One woman's suffering drove her from God. The other woman's suffering drove her toward God. And the difference was one remembered. These are true stories, but you don't know the people involved. So the first woman suffered because her husband left her. And he left her to care for a special needs child, and he left her with a mountain of debt. Naturally, she was angry. She directed some of that anger toward God, and she became bitter. She stopped going to church, and eventually she lost her faith. It just sort of eroded away over time. The other woman was blind. She had always been blind, and she felt that this was unfair. And certainly it was a severe limitation. But she was a woman of faith, and so she prayed that God would give her sight, heal her, and give her sight. And she prayed, and she prayed for a very long time that God would give her sight, until finally she reached the point where she realized God wasn't going to give her sight. Now, at that point, she might have become bitter, but instead, she renewed her commitment to God. She decided to trust that God knows what he is doing. And she said that she felt to continue to pray that way would be to reject God's will. She said, I felt for a long time I'd been telling God, you gave me your life, now give me something else. God delights in giving good things to his children, many good things. But you see what she did there? She remembered, you gave me your life. She remembered. And that's what made the difference. If you are a part of God's covenant family, remembering God's grace is the difference between burden and joy. It can be the difference between turning away to worthless idols and destroying yourself, and finding life and blessing in the living God. Covenant is a relationship of grace. Remember the grace of the Lord. Will you pray with me? Oh God, when we are frustrated, when we are hurting, when we are angry, when we are bitter, when we question you, Lord, we pray that you would remind us of your grace. Draw our eyes to Jesus Christ, to what he did for us. Draw our eyes to your Holy Spirit, who has reached out to us and made us yours. Lord, we pray that every hardship, every difficulty would drive us closer to you, because we know your love and your grace, and we love you. Lord, ask of us what you will, but make it a joy for us to do it. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, let's stand and sing. Our God has done great things.
Come let us bow at his feet. He has done.
as your Savior and the life and the joy that He can give. I'll be up here following the service. I'd love to talk to you about that and how you can know Him and rejoice in His grace. Perhaps you're already a believer but not a member of this church. I'd love to talk to you about how you can be part of our church family. Let me know that you're interested in that. Now, we go forth to live in God's grace, to remember that grace and share it with others, knowing that the power of God that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in us. Amen.